Hey everybody, it's Alex with Engineering Applied. In this video, I'll be giving you a detailed overview of how to place and create components in an assembly file within Autodesk Inventor. If you want more easy to understand and practical content like this, made by an experienced engineer like myself, make sure you like this video, subscribe to the channel, and turn on notifications so you don't miss out on any helpful content like this in the future. Also, if you're looking for a specific function, check the description for timestamps. And if you don't find what you're looking for in this video, make sure you check out the other videos in the Autodesk Inventor series playlist because I know you'll find exactly what you need there. Let's get started. Okay, everybody, so here we are in our blank assembly file. And what we're going to do first is take a look at our placement options for placing components in our workspace or our assembly. And then we're going to be taking a look at how to create various components directly in our assembly file. And we can use this to base new geometry off of other existing components in our assembly. This is really useful for us. So what we're going to do first is open up this dropdown on the left side. And our first option is place. So place essentially allows us to bring in other Inventor part or assembly files and drop those in our workspace within this assembly that we're currently working in. So let's go ahead and click on this, and we're going to bring in the top cover for an electrical enclosure that we've been working on throughout previous lessons. So we're going to click on this, and it's going to open up our place component navigator where we can find our file of interest. So let's go up a level. And then we're going to use our enclosure cover, okay? And so we're going to double click on that. And now you'll notice that it comes up into our workspace, okay? And we can just rotate this around to get a better view. So we can either do one of a few things here. We can left click and just drop it where it is in 3D space. We can right click, and then we get some additional options. So moving up here in our marking menu, we have rotate Z 90 degrees. So basically what this says is we can rotate this part around the Z axis. So imagine you have your part here and your Z axis is running this way with it. You want to revolve that around the Z axis. So imagine your part's revolving around that axis like that. So let's try that. So if we click on that, you'll see that it's revolving around that axis. Okay. We can rotate it about the Y axis as well. So it's going to flip it around this way. Okay. And finally, we have the ability to rotate it around the X axis. So again, it's just gonna flip it around that X axis. And this just essentially helps you get the initial orientation down before you actually drop the part and have to go back and rotate it later. Okay, so that looks good there. So let's go back into our marking menu. Okay, we also have the option to use iMates. I'll get to this option later, and then I'll get into a more detailed iMates video in the future. Okay, so, we also can place this grounded at the origin. So I like to do this for the first part in the assembly that I drop. So in this case, I want this to be the base of my assembly, so to speak. So I'm going to use this option for that. And of course, we can go to our home view, okay, to give us that home isometric view if we need that. Okay, so let's go ahead and place this grounded at the origin. Now let's go ahead and take a look at our place from content center option. So to demonstrate this option, I brought in a placard with various holes drilled into them, and I want to show you how adaptable this feature is. Go ahead and go over to your dropdown, and let's go to place from content center. So when we click on that, it brings up our content center menu where we have tons of standardized hardware available to us to use in our assemblies at any time. For this example, we're going to be using this binding head machine screw that I have pre-selected here. So I'm going to double click on that, and I'm going to hover over the sidewall of this simple hole that I have drilled in our placard here. And you'll notice when I hover over this, we get a green check mark, and the fastener resizes itself accordingly. And again, this hole was sized to be a clearance hole for a 1024 fastener, and you'll see the software read it perfectly. Now we'll go ahead and drop this by left clicking. And now we need to select which surface the head of the screw is mated to, either the top surface or the bottom surface. So if you hover over the top, it turns green and it snaps the base of the screw head to this green surface here. Or if we bring it down to the bottom, it'll snap to an inverted position. So let's bring it back up to the top and left click. Okay. And then now we get our auto drop menu on top of this double headed arrow. This arrow actually allows us to resize the length of the fastener on the fly, which is really cool. So to do that, we're going to click and drag this arrow downwards to increase the length. And right now we're at 1¼ inches long. And I know that by reading inside of this little box here, I see 10-24, which is my fastener size and thread. Okay. And then I also have the 1¼ inch at the end. So that's the length of the fastener. You can also click and drag it up to shorten the fastener as well, but let's go ahead and just drag it out here somewhere and then release the left click on the mouse. And you'll see now we have our standardized size fastener the way we want it. And let's move over to the auto drop menu. The first option in the auto drop menu allows us to change the size of the fastener. So when we click on that, we get a little menu that pops up that tells us our thread description, our nominal length, and our thread type. So you can hit OK once you've made all your selections, and that will input that particular piece of hardware in that location. The next option allows us to apply this piece of hardware as a bolted connection, which is a design accelerator component, if we want to go ahead and do that at this stage. This next option, which is this little green check mark, just simply applies our current set of parameters and allows us to continue dropping more fasteners without exiting out of the command altogether. When we click this check mark, we get an additional menu that asks that we confirm the thread type, which in this case, we want to stick with the UNC thread type, hit OK. And there we go. We've dropped our first fastener, and now we can drop additional ones as needed. So we can hover over this hole, drop it here, OK, and so on and so forth. The final option in this menu is place, and this essentially places the first fastener and exits out of the command without allowing us to place additional units. So if this is the only fastener we want to place, we just click this, select our thread type. Okay, we'll stick with UNC, hit okay. And there we go. It executes the command and then leaves the command window. Now let's go ahead and drop a few more fasteners in before we continue on. So go to your content center. This time I want to pick up the socket head screw. I'm going to double click on that. And I'm going to hover over the clearance hole here and let it size to that. Now this is important. Make sure you're using the clearance hole section for the threads. Don't use the top section for the head of the screw, because if I were to do that, it would oversize the screw and it'd be the wrong size for what I need. So again, use the clearance hole. Okay, left click, and pick the surface you want the head of the screw mated to, which in this case, it's this top surface of the step. So we're gonna go ahead and drop it there, left click, and hit place. Now let's move on to a countersunk fastener. So go back into your content center, and we're gonna go to countersunk. Okay, and this is 100 degree countersink. So I'm just gonna find one that fits this profile. This will work just fine. Okay, hover over the clearance hole, let it resize to that. Left click, and now I want to select this face that I want this coincident to. Okay, so I left click that and it mates it there. And let's drag the length out just a little bit. Okay, there we go, and hit place. Select our thread type. And there we go. Now we have our countersunk fastener placed exactly how we needed it to, and you'll see it's nice and flush to this top surface. Now let's go ahead and drop a fastener into this threaded hole at the end of the placard. Go to your content center. We're going to use this binding head machine screw. Hover over the threaded portion, let it snap to that, and you see it's sized to the threads, which are 3/8 by 16, okay, which is all appropriate for this. Left click, snap the head of the fastener to this top surface, and let's rotate this a little bit and check the length. Okay, so the length looks good. It's a little bit underneath this bottom surface, which is correct. We don't want it protruding past the bottom surface in this case, because this is a threaded hole, and we want to hit place. And there we go. Now we have our fastener assigned just the way we needed it. This next option allows us to place imported CAD files into our assembly. So when we click on this, it brings up this little dialog box, and we can pick up our file of interest from this menu. So I went ahead and downloaded a bunch of different step files from a distributor I like to use. And let's go ahead and just pull in a piece of this T-slotted framing. So I just double click on this, and we get a window that pops up with our import options. I'm going to leave all of this alone. It basically allows you to pick up various features or whatever is found in that step file. Okay, so this looks good to me. I'm going to hit OK. And there we go. Now it imported our little piece of hardware. You can move it around in the 3D space. And then when you're ready to drop it, you can either right click and place it grounded at the origin and do all of your normal rotation stuff, or you can just left click and drop it anywhere in 3D space. So we'll do that. And there we go. Now we have our imported CAD geometry. Next, we can place an iLogic component into our assembly, or we can actually place electrical components from our catalog browser if we wish to do so. Moving over to the right, we have our create option. So this allows us to create new parts or assemblies within the assembly that we're actively working in at this time. This is really valuable when you're creating new geometry that must reference other sub-assemblies or other components within the assembly that you're actively working in. So you could essentially go through and design a whole top level assembly piece by piece, all in one workspace. Let's go ahead and click on create. And now we get this dialog box that allows us to rename our component, select the type of component that it is, so we can change it to a sheet metal part, a standard assembly, a standard part, or a weldment assembly, okay? So in this case, we just wanna leave it as a standard part. Moving over to the right, we have our browse templates option if we wanna abide by a certain template that we have in our workspace, okay? Now we have our file location, so you can change the file location for this new part. So this is really valuable. So you can control all of your part hierarchy and your file structure all in this window. Now we have our BOM structure, so we can just leave that on normal. You're more than welcome to change this based on your BOM structure of choice. This little checkbox here allows us to make it a virtual component. So essentially all a virtual component is it's like a placeholder in your assembly. Let's say, for example, you want to have in your bill of materials a space that shows a thread locker that you're using on your fasteners to keep them locked into place so they don't back out during normal use due to vibrations and other factors, okay? So you wouldn't normally model thread locker, okay, in your model, but you want it to show up in your bill of materials when you're generating your engineering drawings so your manufacturing crew doesn't miss out on that particular line item that's crucial to your design. So that's what your virtual component can be used for, and it's a really good feature for when you're designing a product. Moving down to this final option, this essentially allows us to constrain our new sketch plane for our new part that we're creating in this space to an existing plane or face within our assembly. So essentially what this allows us to do is it allows us to automate the mating process with our new part. So for example, I used this when I created my bottom cover as part of this whole assembly. So I have the top cover here, the bottom cover, okay? And then we have our screws that attach the two together. Our constraint lies between this top face and this bottom face here on this lip. So when I created that new part, that's where I started that sketch plane, and it automatically created that mate or that constraint for me. However, I would like to add that usually you'll want to leave that unchecked if you want to maintain complete control over how your parts are mated together. So it just really depends on your design intent and how you're developing that new part and how it interfaces with your existing assembly. So again, I would typically leave that disabled so you can maintain complete control over your mating and constraint process, but it's entirely up to you. So we're back in our creation dialog box. I just renamed the part to bottom cover. I'm gonna hit okay. And now I want to roll this part over, and I wanna select this face as the starting face because this is where I want that outer lip to be flush with. Okay, so I just left click on that, and you'll see the part sort of goes into like a transparent view. When it does this, that means that I'm editing a specific part and I'm not in the assembly currently. And if you look at the ribbon along the top, I have this return option. So I can, you know, model up my part. So let's go ahead and just throw a sketch in here real quick. Okay, click on that. And let's go ahead and just project some geometry. Okay, close this out with some lines. We'll hit okay, and then finish 2D sketch. Now this is a crude representation of what you can actually do with this, but I just wanna save you all some time. Okay, so we go to extrude, and let's go ahead and just shorten that up a little bit. So this is how you would start your new component using this feature. We'll hit okay. Now you'll see that the top portion is still transparent, but we can see the bottom portion just fine. That is because we're still editing this new part. Now let's say I wanna go back to the assembly. All you have to do is click return, and now we're back in our assembly. Well, how do we go back to editing that part again? Well, you can hover over this bottom cover or whatever part that you've added, right click, and then you want to select edit. And when you do that, we can go back into editing the part again. And then when we're done, we can go back to return and just make sure you're saving all of your files as you move along. Now, before I go ahead and wrap up this video, I want to show you how to use iMates to quickly place the fasteners through the bottom cover. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna rotate this bottom cover around, and we're gonna go up to manage, okay, the manage tab, go over to iMate. And now we wanna use this option called insert. So you left click on that, and you wanna select this this top edge here. So this is where the screw head is going to position. And you see that little axis through the middle of that circle. That's showing a concentric relationship to that feature. So I'm gonna left click, hit apply, and I'm gonna do that for all of these holes. So I'm gonna left click, okay? Just move through all of these. There we go. Now we've applied everything to our bottom cover. Now let's do the same thing with our fastener. So I'm in my fastener part file. It's a self-tapping screw, okay? Let's go up to manage, iMate, insert, okay? And then I just wanna pick this bottom face here, okay? So this is where it's going to interface with that hole. Left click on that, hit okay. And now let's go back into our assembly. So when we're back in our assembly, let's go ahead and place a new file. Go ahead and select the fastener with the iMate constraint that you applied to it. double click on that, and you'll see we have a little blue highlight here or outline of the fastener. Okay. And you'll see that it already has all of the relationships that we need in reference to this bottom cover. So you can left click and it'll step through individually and place these components individually, or you can right click and then go down to place at all matching iMates. Click on that and it'll automatically select all of those locations where you have those iMates, and it knows exactly what to do with it. So if you have a large hole pattern or something where you're using a lot of fasteners that are the same and you want to apply that same iMate constraint, this is a very quick way to model that up in your assembly. That's all for this segment of the Autodesk Inventor assembly creation module, where I gave you an overview of how to place and create components in an assembly file. I really hope that you found this tutorial to be helpful and that you put what you've learned into practice so you can continue developing your skills as you work your way through these lessons. Also, before you watch the next video in the series, make sure you subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications to stay up to date on future content that will help you create the future you want for yourself. And of course, don't hesitate to leave a comment or reach out via my website contact page and let me know if there's anything else you'd like to learn about or see on this channel. I really appreciate you choosing to stop by and learn with me, and I'll see you again soon.